change gonna come. Oh, yes it will.
Hi, everybody. Good day and good morning for those of you joining us from the West Coast. My name is Robert Espinoza, and I'm the Vice President of Policy at PHI. For those of you who don't know PHI, we are a national organization that's dedicated to strengthening the direct care workforce through research, through advocacy, and through workforce innovation. I'm really excited about today's webinar and from hearing from the panelists who have joined us this morning or today. I do want to say just a few things before we start. Hannah Diamond, my colleague, is available for any technical support questions, so please feel free to reach out to her through the chat feature. Also, we'll be recording the webinar and making it available on our website in the next week or so, so please keep an eye out for that recording. Also, if you're interested in live transcription, you can click on the live transcription button and simply click show subtitles. The flow of this webinar, I will offer some opening remarks, some comments about the purpose of this webinar, and then we'll hear from each of our panelists. If you have questions throughout the webinar, please feel free to include them in the chat. We will also open up the conversation at the end of all the presentations to answer some of the key questions, but we do ask that people include those in the chat feature so that we can address them as needed. Also, please keep yourself on mute, and we encourage people to also keep themselves off camera just to make the presentation a little bit more fluent. So with that said, let me introduce our panelists today. We'll first hear from Ariane Hegewisch, who is the Program Director of Employment and Earnings at the Institute for Women's Policy Research. They are a leading national think tank that builds evidence to shape policies that grow women's power and influence, close inequality gaps, and improve the economic well-being of families. We'll then hear from Ruqaiijah Yearby. She is a full professor and member of the Center for Health Law Studies at St. Louis University, and a co-founder and executive director of St. Louis University's Institute for Healing Justice and Equity. Third, we'll hear from Mayte Lopez, who is a home health program coordinator at Encuentro. She is also a member of the steering committee for the Essential Jobs, Essential Care Initiative, which is PHI's initiative in New Mexico with the New Mexico Caregivers Coalition. Encuentro's mission is to strengthen immigrant parents, families, and communities in New Mexico. So welcome to all of our panelists today. For those of you who are interested in why we're doing this webinar and just to set the frame, last week PHI released research that showed the racial and gender disparities that exist within the direct care workforce. And I just want to highlight a few statistics to frame the kind of discussion that we're having today. First, I want to point out that our research does show that women of color are a significant part of the workforce and are a significant growing proportion of the workforce. From 2009 to 2019, they grew from 45 to 53% of the direct care workforce. Unfortunately, women of color are also more likely to be in poverty or live in or near poverty than men and white women. About 47% of women of color in direct care live in or near poverty, compared to 41% of white men, 39% of white women, and 36% of men of color. Also, when you look more closely at racial disparities in other ways, we show that, for example, Hispanic Latino workers in direct care have the lowest annual earnings of any racial or ethnic group. They earn about $18,200 in annual earnings, compared to $22,200 for Black African-American workers and about $20,000 for API white and workers of another race. A third statistic that I want to share before we start today's present conversation is that Black African-American direct care workers have the lowest family income among all direct care workers. They have a family income of about $40,000 a year, compared to $41,200 for workers of another race, $46,200 for white workers, $47,000 a year for Hispanic workers, and $70,700 for Asian Pacific Islander workers. So it's clear that direct care workers as an entire workforce are facing severe challenges with job quality and with their economic stability, but specifically for women of color, for specific populations of color, it is clear that those racial and gender disparities are having an impact on their economic stability. This is a quote from Vera Germain, who is a home health aide at JAS in Brooklyn, New York. She says, "I'm a single parent working 6 days a week, and I don't spend enough time with my kid. As home health aides, we work too hard, and we're not getting paid for how hard we work. That's the problem." Keo Seifan, who is a home care provider and a caregiver emergency response team provider at Homebridge in San Francisco, California, says, quote, "My parents are refugee from Laos, and in the main culture, I should be the one giving them the care they need. I am an only child, and they are getting older, but they are hundreds of miles away." Teresita Sitar says, "As a caregiver, I learned that this job is being looked down on, very much exploited, especially with regards to immigrants of color, particularly women." It's in this context that last week PHI launched the Direct Care Worker Equity Institute, which is an institute that's committed to addressing these systemic inequities and profound disparities facing direct care workers. Through this institute, we are compiling resources, we are issuing new studies and new policy analyses, and we are designing workforce interventions with the explicit focus on tackling inequities within the direct care workforce, of course, to improve the entire long-term care system, not just the jobs and the economic stabilities of workers. In that context, I do want to introduce our first speaker. Speaking first is Ariane Hegewisch, who is the Program Director of Employment and Earnings at the Institute for Women's Policy Research. Ariane?
Thank you very much. Let me see, I'm trying to share my screen. Oops. Right, great. Thank you so much, Robert. It's a great honor to be part of this webinar, and we often use PHI's data and leadership in this sector. As Robert said, I work for a think tank, the Institute for Women's Policy Research, and we are focused on women's economic equity. Care work, of course, is essential to ensuring women's equity. And being from a think tank, I hope I'm not going to be too geekish, but trying to step back a little bit and also look at connections to the wage gap over time and the evaluation of women's work. So just to start with a few data points that probably most of you are listening to this will be familiar with. The COVID-19 pandemic has intensified and is continuing to do so the underlying inequities. firstly, the she session, women are still twice as likely to be out of jobs as men. They're 2 million jobs below the level before the pandemic compared to 1 million jobs for men. And this is partly due to the lack of the recovery in the nursing and residential care and childcare sector, which is six times as far behind the general recovery than the overall economy. So without care and without care jobs, women have fewer jobs and fewer access to paid employment. And of course, what the COVID pandemic has done is to re-intensify who does what at home and pushing women to do family care work. Second, as Robert has already said, the direct care work is at the same time one of the least diverse workforces, but also one of the most diverse. 9 in 10, 87% of the workers are women, though the number of men, particularly men of color, is rising. 1.5 are women of color, and that goes to 6 in 10 of the women workers in direct care, and over a quarter are immigrants. And the earnings are very low. $13 an hour in 2020 with the median. The median means half earn less. It's not like the minimum wage, so very low paid. Robert already mentioned what this means. Even if you work full time, it leaves a lot of families below or near poverty. Part-time work is very high. And we always say, you know, we have this way of differentiating between voluntary and involuntary part-time work. But over half of care workers work part-time because they themselves have childcare or family care responsibilities. So voluntary doesn't quite describe it. And then, of course, access to benefits is very poor, and particularly during the pandemic, not to have paid sick time is particularly damaging. Fewer than half of part-time workers generally get paid sick days. Latinos are least likely than anybody else to get paid access to sick times, and deep inequity, which also can push people out of unemployment. Now, the geekish part, probably, again, everybody knows, over the last 20 years or so, employment in the direct care workforce and home health care services has exploded. And in home health care services alone has grown 9 times as fast as the size of the general workforce. And the reason I mention that is because at the same time, progress in closing the gender wage gap has really stalled. What we have here is a simple linear progression, simple back of the envelope almost calculation of what would happen if progress in closing the gender wage gap continued at the same pace as it has since the mid 80s. And for all women and men, that means waiting almost another 40 years. But for Latinas, it would take over almost 200 years to reach equity. And for Black women, well over 100 years. And this is just full-time workers. So huge equity gaps. Of course, how care comes into this inequity is, where we are now, we don't have a good leave or work family benefit system. The cost of childcare, disability, or elder care is enormous. So when there are care responsibilities, women may have to switch to part-time jobs or lose or leave their job. Means earnings go down, lifetime's earnings go down, and when they come back, they have to start at a lower level. And on the other hand, if you have a working childcare system and elder care system with well care jobs, people can stay in jobs and build up their earnings, and the wage gap falls. Now, again, what is behind this unequal pay? There are two big factors, which I think are very relevant to care work. One is occupational segregation or sector segregation. What this means is that women tend to work in different jobs from men, and like care work, the jobs that women predominantly do tend to pay much less per education and per experience level that you need. And the second factor is discrimination, and this is discrimination in pay, but just as much it is discrimination in hiring and promotion. Who gets the good jobs? Who can advance in their jobs? Who gets the opportunity to kind of really develop themselves? Now, I think this is a fairly startling statistic. We did this, a colleague of mine did this analysis. What would happen if women were earning as much as men at the same level of education and working the same hours, same age? The rate of poverty for all working women would be cut in half, and the rate of poverty for single mothers would have fallen from almost 30% or 29% to 15%. So huge impact on poverty in this sense. And GDP would rise. That's of course a what if situation, but it points at the urgency to do something around this. Now, last issue, why is care work so undervalued, right? Why, given that it is so essential and all of us know it's essential, why are earnings and conditions so poor? The first issue is it's perceived as women's work, culturally, historically. Something that women like to do, are naturally good at, don't have to learn. Maybe we should pay to do it because it's so nice. The second issue is many aspects of this work, such as emotional work, are hard to measure and hard to prove, harder than, building a car or designing software programs. So it's often ignored. And with this comes out undervaluing and underrecognition of the physical nature and the physical risk of working in these occupations. And again, meaning that there's less money less earnings to recognize this value. The second factor, particularly in the US, is the legacy of slavery and the fact that Black women had to provide care work as part of slavery in the home. And Ruqaiijah is going to say much more of how this perpetrates our employment system now and the structural racism that Black women and all caregivers face. And then of course the US has notoriously weak labor rights, immigration policies, disadvantaged workers. The policies against union organizing are very strong. And this last point here is not an example of weak labor rights, but I looked at the wage gap in the in care between care workers and other workers in other high income countries. You find a significant wage gap almost everywhere. This undervaluation of care is more universal. But the countries with the lowest gap are the ones where there are sector collective agreements that cover care workers and that put them in relationship to other workers with collective agreements. And now my last point is the fact that care services cannot be provided by the market. You cannot say, just leave it, to people buying services because it's very labor intensive. It's not something you automate. And that means it has to be a social infrastructure. It has to be provided through taxation or through other supports, and we have to set general standards. And so with this, I'll now pass over to Ruqaiijah. Stop sharing. Thank you.
Hello. So I want to share my slides. Today, I am going to be speaking about racism law and health justice. I will focus on the revised social determinants of health model and racism and how it plays a part, particularly in what we're talking about, direct care workers' benefits and wages, how it's compounded by some Medicaid gaps, and then just provide one quick example on the health justice framework. So this is a model that I published in 2020, which shows how systemic discrimination, including systemic racism, impacts economic stability. One of the tools of systemic racism is law. And I'll talk about this more throughout my presentation, which leads to disadvantages in employment, which have been associated with poor health and mental health outcomes. So when we look at systemic racism, it includes quite a bit, including social structures, interpersonal interactions, cultural beliefs about who is valued, who deserves particular access to resources, and its use in its dominance to disempower and devalue particular groups. Racism is about power and does not require bad intent. And I'm going to focus today on structural racism, particularly the ways that laws, policies, and practices are used to structure systems. And again, I'm going to focus on the employment system to advantage dominant groups and disadvantage minority groups. It also includes the ways that organizations work together to create separate and independent barriers through the neutral denial of equal treatment. And as I mentioned before, it does not require bad intent. And so let's talk about the ways that this shows up, particularly for direct care workers in terms of employment. Most direct care workers who are racial and ethnic minority workers are not covered by many of the labor protections. So let's start with the National Labor Relations Act of 1935, expanded union rights for workers, which has resulted in higher wages and benefits such as health insurance, employer-sponsored health insurance, as well as paid sick leave. And so when this act was passed, the federal government allowed the exemption of domestic workers, which direct care workers fall under. Second, the Fair Labor Standards Act of 1938 limited the work week to 40 hours and established federal minimum wage and overtime requirements. And again, exempted out were domestic care, were domestic workers. And finally, in many of the COVID-19 economic relief bills, we see that some of these workers are not covered either explicitly because there were worries about staffing shortages or because of the type of employer that is covered. I want to go into a little bit more detail about one, and that's the Fair Labor Standards Act, which limited, as I mentioned, the work week and established a minimum wage. As I said, exempted domestic agriculture and service occupations, which were predominantly filled by racial and ethnic minorities. We have seen some changes in these laws. It was amended to cover domestic workers, but still did not cover all domestic workers, including some direct care workers who provide services in the home. Since that time, we particularly under President Obama, we see the expansion of the Fair Labor Standards Act to cover direct care workers. But what we see now is that many of these workers are labeled as independent contractors. And as such, they have been left out of being covered under the Fair Labor Standards Act. They also do not qualify for workers' compensation, unemployment compensation, and health and safety protections. So again, this is an example of structural racism, the ways that laws, policies, and practice are used to disadvantage racial and ethnic minorities, but to advantage, traditionally to advantage white, either white workers or white businesses that do not have to cover or provide the benefits. We can see this playing out as well in terms of Medicaid. Most of direct care workers are covered under Medicaid for the services they provide. What we tend to see when states have budget shortfalls is for them to actually decrease the rate of payment. And so here you can see the shortfalls that have been happening, particularly during COVID-19. And the research shows that what traditionally happens is that Medicaid makes provider payment cuts. And so we have a population that is already being paid low wages, already lacking benefits such as paid sick leave, workers' comp, health insurance, and then the state further cuts these reimbursement rates to be able to address some of their state budgetary shortfalls. So what do we need to do? One of the examples I like to use is the equity and equality picture to show that we really need to move towards equity, right? Not to say that we're going to give everybody the same benefits, but ensure that we are providing what is needed by each particular group. And so when we think about direct care workers, we need to adopt a health justice framework. And this framework is based in part on the reproductive justice framework, the environmental justice, civil rights movements, and really steeped in human rights. It's not about just protecting people from harm, but actually providing what they need equitably to ensure that they can continue to provide care and to live. There are three particular principles. One is that we need to begin to address systemic racism, particularly structural racism and its impact on workers. We need to review the laws and practices and think about the ways that they disproportionately harm direct care workers, particularly racial and ethnic minority workers. We also need for communities to drive this. So we need impacted communities, particularly racial and ethnic minority communities, to lead, drive the creation, implementation, and evaluation of any interventions to address systemic and structural racism, particularly when we think about paid sick leave policies. Imagine what it would look like if workers actually were the ones leading this change. It would not be the same requirements that we saw pass under COVID-19 that left many direct care workers out. Finally, the interventions must be accompanied by financial supports and accommodations to redress harm. And so this goes back again to what I said about equity. We must understand how direct care workers have been impacted over a number of years and generations in doing this work without equal access to a living wage, health insurance benefits, and protections from getting hurt at work. And with that, I just want to highlight a couple of articles that I have written along with Professor Seema Moapatra, Professor Emily Benfer, Professor Lindsay Wiley about the health justice framework, as well as how law structural racism has impacted many of these workers during the COVID-19 pandemic. Thank you.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Mayte Lopez. I use she, her pronouns. And today I'm going to be speaking about a very key demographic of people in the direct care workforce. And so today I'm going to be speaking specifically about immigrants in the direct care workforce. And so when we talk about immigrant caregivers, we really need to understand who it is that we're actually talking about. And so when we're saying immigrant caregivers, the people that we're speaking on are actually 61% of the direct care workforce in this country right now are people of color, right? And so there are 4.5 million direct care workers in the nation. And of those 4.5 million direct care workers, 61% identify as people of color. And of that 61%, 89% of those who identified as Asian or Pacific Islander are immigrants. 46% of those who identified as Hispanic or Latino are immigrants, and 29% of those who identified as Black or African are immigrants. And so what this one in four of all direct care workers in the country right now are immigrants. And so we have to understand, we have to recognize that the issues that immigrants are facing are actually issues that the direct care industry is facing. And so I just want to talk a little bit about what those points are. What are those key issues that immigrant caregivers face? And so the first thing that I want to speak on is work authorization. And so when we talk about work authorization, what we're talking about is employment eligibility. And one of the issues under work authorization is that if one in four direct care workers are immigrants, potentially one in four direct care workers do not have access to what we call formal employment. And so agencies, nursing homes, those who use Medicare, Medicaid dollars to pay for care are actually inaccessible potentially to one in four direct care workers. Another issue under work authorization is not just the lack of formal employment, but there's also this fear and anxiety that immigrants face on a daily level around their status being brought into question. And so typically what people tend to do is kind of opt out of activities that would bring attention to their status or potentially affect positively or negatively their status. And because of this fear and anxiety that immigrants live with every day, they are actually very vulnerable to unethical labor practices. And so things like wage theft, things like discrimination, things like harassment, to name a few, are things that a lot of immigrants face in this industry, unfortunately. The other thing that I want to talk about is the lack of long-term socioeconomic resources. And so when immigrants come to this country, a lot of the time, they don't speak English. They don't have an established community or established sense of communal identity. And so there's a big sense of isolation when it comes to immigrants in this country in general. And because of that, there's like a lack of cultural proximity. There's a lack of understanding of the systems and the resources that are available to them. And we go back to that work authorization question. Am I allowed to look for resources and benefit from these resources without it actually affecting my status or bringing my status into question? And so there's isolation, the lack of cultural proximity, and there's a lack of resources that are actually helpful for immigrants in the care workforce that help with establishment and integration into the community. A lot of the times the resources that are available to immigrant caregivers or immigrants in general are short-term. And so it doesn't really give people the ability to establish themselves as people in the community. And another thing is that there is a lack of resources for alternative economic opportunities. So as I had said before, there is a lack of accessibility to what is called formal employment. And because there's a lack of that accessibility, there needs to be something else that's happening. And unfortunately, there aren't a lot of resources as far as like other options to be able to work in this industry and still fulfill your duties as far as, tax code and things like that goes. And so people come here without really understanding what is available to them. And there really isn't anything that is helping as far as like long-term status and integration into the community. One of the other issues is a lack of specialized training. And so as a direct caregiver, as somebody who cares for other people in their home or in an agency, as Ariane was saying before, it tends to be something that women of color do. And before, it wasn't ever something that had any kind of training or any kind of specialization in, right? A lot of the times people don't understand that this is actually a very highly skilled profession. It does require training. It does require a lot of skills and abilities that not everybody has access to and not everybody has as it is. And so one of the things that is really hard for immigrant and caregivers is that there's a lack of culturally and linguistically specific and relevant training programs. So not only is there a lack of training programs, but there's a lack of culturally and linguistically accessible programs. And so as we're talking about immigrant caregivers and we're talking about isolation and lack of resources, training is one of the biggest things that I think that they face. there is a scarcity of certification programs. A lot of the time what happens is that training is done on the job. You're trained on the job, within a few hours, you're on the floor and you're taking care of people. And so if there aren't a lot of certification programs that somebody can participate in and actually establish, you know, their skills and their abilities. And so these are the kind of these are the three issues that I think that are actually probably the biggest barriers that immigrant caregivers face as far as the industry and culturally speaking. And so why does this matter? Why does it matter that one in four direct care workers are facing this issue? When we speak about the population of elders, those who are aging 65 or older, there's currently around 55 million people. And there's a projection of upwards of 80 million people in the next 20 years. And as we can see in this graph, you know, people who are 85 years or older, people who are 65 years or older, that projection is well over 90% as far as population growth goes. Currently in this industry, there is a turnover rate between 40 to 60%. And the diversity among the aging population is increasing. And so when we talk about the issues that immigrant caregivers are facing, like I said before, it's actually what the direct care industry is facing. And we need to fill these positions. We need to understand that care is a very essential part of our society, right? And so it's very important for us to understand that a lot of the things that our caregivers are facing are issues that everything else is facing, right? And so I work at Encuentro. I work at a nonprofit in Albuquerque, New Mexico. I'm a training specialist for home health aides. And so what we did is we took all of this information. We heard the concerns of our community. We heard the concerns of our students. And you know, the issues that I was talking about as far as work authorization, as far as the socioeconomic resources and specialized training. And we kind of came to a call where we answered that. When we answered those issues, and we tried to do it in a very wraparound community-based approach. And so our training program specifically is guided by three pillars. We are guided by leadership development, education, and economic opportunity. And so this allows for a wraparound community-based approach to training and to the care industry. And so I just want to show this infographic. This is what our theory of change is. And so as you can see, I have right here the three pillars that our program is guided by: leadership development, education, and economic opportunity. And so what this program is it's client-centered and it's worker-centered. So all the issues that the workers are facing are being taken into account when we do this training program. We understand that the home health aide and the client they go hand in hand as far as the relationship goes and as far as being able to build this care industry and build, you know, a better care industry for our society, right? And so we have client-centered and caregiver-centered training. And what we expect is that our home health aides, you know, they get the professional development, they understand and have training around income generation and different opportunities to economic viability. And it's all about wellness. It's all about care. It's all about dignity for the client and dignity for the worker, right? And so as we had seen in this webinar so far, it's that the direct care industry, unfortunately, and for many years, has been something that has kind of been pushed aside, hasn't been looked at as a respectable profession, when in fact it really is. We live in a care cycle. Everybody in their life is gonna need care at some point. And so that's what our approach is understanding that having workers understood and supported and having clients understood and supported is gonna make for a better society, a better community, right? If we're actually paying attention to the needs of our most vulnerable population. And so through professional development, through business ownership that we do in our program, we're working towards health and well-being, community, and social justice. And so I do wanna give a couple of key facts for our training program. Currently, it is a 15-week certification program for a personal care attendant, home health aide, and they are CPR first aid HeartSaver certified. We currently exceed New Mexico Department of Health requirements for training. And to this date, we have 220 graduates with a 98% graduation and retention rate since 2016. And so when I'm speaking about, when I was speaking earlier about the work authorization, lack of socioeconomic resources, and lack of specialized training, we kind of hit all three of those points on the head. And so not only is it that they are receiving the training and the skills in order to be able to provide this care, but they're also receiving childcare while they are in class. They are receiving help as far as obtaining jobs after they graduate from the program. They have continuing education, quarterly meetings, and many other things like that that help them to be maintain their status and be involved in our programs. Another thing about that is that, like I was talking about before, this business ownership is that we focus on an independent contractor lens. We focus on letting our home health aides know that there are other economic opportunities besides the traditional agency for-profit way that we know. And so what we've recognized is that having all of these fears and anxieties, taken care of, having all of these needs met, understanding where our caregivers are coming from has actually been the secret to our success. It has been key to the success of our program. And so what I would like to say as far as like solution and action items for those who are in attendance today is to really express concern with elected officials about the crisis that the direct care industry is facing. A lot of people tend not to know that this is actually happening right now. And as we can see, one in four direct care workers are immigrants. And so immigrant rights and immigrant protections are very important, not just to immigrants, but to this industry. And so advocate for immigrant rights and protections. Support the National Domestic Workers Alliance and other organizations that are doing work around that, like PHI as well. And support community-based approaches to care, like Encuentro's model, where it is caregiver-centered and client-centered. And that is, like I said, the key to our success and to our programs. So I just wanted to say that and thank you so much.
Thank you, Mayte, and thank you again, Ariane and Ruqaiijah. As you can tell from the comments, there's a great deal of appreciation for all of the insights and data that you've all shared, as well as a few questions that I'll pose in a moment. But I do want to reflect on the fact that, you know, some of the words that people are using are compelling, fascinating, so valuable and informative descriptions of history, context, and reason. Ariane, someone appreciates the geekiness, which is truly valuable. Also, somebody pointed out that there is another version of the equity picture that Ruqaiijah shared that includes removing the wooden fence and installing a chain so that everyone can view the game. And I think somebody referred to it as the liberation image. There are a number of questions, Mayte, about the Encuentro program. People want to know, for example, are the caregivers able to work during those 15 weeks of training? What do they get paid? Can you share more about the childcare aspects of this work, who funds this program, et cetera? Can you answer just some of these questions and give people a little bit more flavor of those details?
Sure, of course. Thank you so much for these questions. So typically when people come into the 15-week training program, they already have experience in care. They're currently working in healthcare and in direct care. So they are able to work. A lot of them are currently working while they're in the class. There is actually also a component for paid internships, subsidized internships as part of our program as well. And so they are usually working in the industry. As far as the child care goes, what we do is we actually provide child care in-house. This was when we were in person, of course. But we do provide child care for our students, recognizing that many of them are women. I think 97% of our students are women, 97% of our graduates are women and parents. And so they have small children and, you know, typically they can't take a class if they don't have childcare. And so we provide childcare in the building for our students that, you know, their children can be there while they're studying. And I'm sorry, I forgot the last question was about funding. So we currently are funded, you know, through the Kellogg grant. We have USDA grants, Kellogg Foundation, excuse me. And so we have a number of grants that are kind of focusing on this direct care workforce, but mainly through Kellogg and through USDA and through the National Domestic Workers Alliance and as well, and the Anderson Foundation.
Thank you, Mayte. I do welcome anyone else who has a question to either pose it in the chat or to go off mute and feel free to ask your question. Let me ask a question for any of the panelists while we wait for other people's questions. A general question, which is, in the last 10 years or so, where have you seen progress in the work that you've done? And where have you seen retrenchment? Where do you think are some of those points that we can either build on or immediately challenge?
Oh, sorry. I forget I was off mute. Sorry. I would say where I see some hopeful movement is people understanding that paid sick leave is so key to worker health and well-being. And so my hope is that we will actually expand it to direct care workers, regardless of their immigration status, that if they are working, if they're providing care, that we actually provide those benefits to people because it's so needed.
Thank you, Ruqaiijah. I see a hand raised from Diane Carter. Diane, do you want to go off mute?
Yes. A question I had is related to something that's making the news in Colorado, is that nursing assistants, in particular in nursing homes, are leaving the nursing home employment and going to private agencies that are charging the nursing homes up to double. And my personal opinion is good for them. But the issue I have is that, and then they're going back to that nursing home to cover shifts, the nursing home they were just in. Could one or all of you comment on how that might be used to leverage our system of inadequacy, horrible inadequacy is a silly word. Anyway, horrible issues. Yeah.
Thank you, Diane. Does somebody want to tackle that question?
I think this is such a good point. It is something, you know, say if you take registered nurses, it has something that has been around for a very long time. And maybe I'm not at my most optimistic today. It hasn't led to a major shift yet, but I think one of the issues, earnings are a key issue, and perhaps now that it really hits the insurance or the state sector's pockets, they may be doing something. The other issue tends to be the hours that you can get. So it's not just earnings, but also shifts. And then often if you work through agencies, you have more control over when you work. And the problem is that if you become directly employed, particularly at the moment, you know, you're just really pushed into working whenever, and people don't want that. So to the question before, the positive issue is that our awareness of the need for change in care work and the essential nature of care and how badly treated care workers are has really gone up. So maybe there are opportunities to lift this up and change the industry.
Thank you.
Thank you, Ariane. We have a few more questions trickling in. Someone pointed out that the legal and structural issues are huge and long-range bodies of work. How can we scale more readily some of these examples of positive outliers more effectively and quickly, given how urgent the needs are both for the workforce and the persons who need care in the home and in the community? Does somebody want to tackle that?
I can jump in really quickly just to say, I think that a lot of states are looking at wage pass-through programs, which under Medicaid is supposed to increase wages that go to direct care workers and other workers who are providing health services in home-based community care, as well as nursing homes. So I think there has been a move to actually see the ways that states can adopt those programs. I think for me, it's just to ensure if they are going to, that it is not going to get negatively impacted during a recession, right? And so sometimes you'll see in some states, I think New York City, New Jersey, where they actually tie it to minimum wage. And so that's a way to sort of recession-proof some of those policies.
Thank you, Ruqaiijah. Another question, this might be more for Mayte. There's a question, is the funding you receive meant to help establish a career ladder? Can the funding be used to increase hourly wages for the workers? And if so, is there a plan to keep those increases in place?
Thank you, Robert. Thanks for that question. Over the past, I would say, 3 or 4 years, we have seen an increase in the wages of our home health aides who are working as independent contractors. And so what I mentioned when I was speaking was around, we are actually centered around independent contractor models as opposed to working at an agency, right? So working directly in the home of a person. And so we actually have, I think on average, an independent contractor that graduated from our program makes about $18 an hour compared to $11 an hour for a person who is working in the industry in an agency. And so throughout the entire program, we talk about the independent contractor model and how somebody can succeed in that way. We also provide, we have a matching registry in which our graduates can actually be connected to people in the community who are looking for care as far as like interviews and things like that goes. So that's one of the things. The other thing is that we do have some graduates that are developing a worker owner co-op for care. And so it's not necessarily about establishing a career ladder, I would say. It's more of opening up the economic opportunities to our graduates and helping them understand that they actually have a lot more control over how they engage in these spaces than they are led to believe, especially around agency for-profit industry work. So I hope that that kind of answers the question.
Yes, thank you, Mayte. And you might have answered this question as well, but somebody asked, what kind of advice do you give graduates about how to find the best, most responsible employers?
So one of the things that we do, so we, one of the most important things I think is that we advocate for an $18 an hour wage throughout all of the spaces of our program. So that's in the matching registry, that's in the co-op space, that's in our training program. And you know, any volunteer things that we do is always at least $18 an hour. So that's one of the things that we advocate as a group. To help as far as advising our graduates. Another thing that we do throughout the program is, and this is building on that leadership development pillar that I was mentioning before, is recognizing or is allowing our students to recognize the power that they hold in these spaces. And one of the things that I think is most important for that to happen is to understand the importance of this care work that they're doing, right? And so the way that we advise our students is to recognize that they are experts in their field. They were hired and they were brought in for a reason. The second thing is to advocate for just wages. You know, we also have workshops and things around using a contract, negotiating contracts. We have a lot of webinars, you know, and like quarterly meetings and things like that that we do around interviews, around how to advocate for oneself, how to set boundaries, how to keep those boundaries, you know. So it really is about worker empowerment. And I don't even want to use that that phrase, worker recognition of power, really. I think that that's probably the way that people are able to succeed in this is to recognize that they do hold power and that they are important and that they are valued.
Absolutely. Thank you, Mayte. I want to ask a question somebody posed related to food insecurity. This person said, I manage a program focused on local food access for low-income seniors. In this program, seniors who need direct care workers may not be able to access the program due to lack of transportation, and some seniors access it via direct care worker doing food shopping for them. I'm curious whether any panelists know of programs that specifically support both direct care workers and seniors with food access. I would also broaden it to say, can anyone speak to the issues involving food insecurity and the workforce or any of the populations that you focus on?
I'm going to try to talk a little bit about that. And this is just from the experience that we actually have in our training program. So one of the components of our training program is an elderly food and nutrition course. And so our graduates are able to take this nutrition course and learn about CSAs, local CSAs, local places to shop for food, things that they can do with very limited resources as far as like creating healthy meals for their clients. And again, this is just from how our program works, but we currently, those students who are in the nutrition program they also have access to a program called Refresh. And so they get local vegetables and fruits from locally grown spaces. And so that's one of the things that we help our care groups with as far as like food insecurities go. And so that's kind of helping bridge the gap between where the seniors that are having those food insecurities and our home health aides who have access to those programs. So that's just kind of how we have taken that on.
Well, thank you, Mayte. We have a number of questions and comments in the chat, but unfortunately we have run out of time. I do want to say an enormous thank you to all three of you, Ariane, Ruqaiijah, and Mayte, for all of your insights, for engaging in this webinar. And I want to thank everybody who attended, and thank you for sharing your comments, your questions, and all of your insights. Again, we have recorded this webinar, and we will publish it on our website along with the slides, making them widely available. And we encourage anyone to reach out to us to further the conversation that was had today. So again, thank you, and please enjoy your day.